Hey, Cabby Boarders here. You are watching Imagination TV. Let me ask you a few questions. Ever wished you were free to pursue your passion instead of just punching a clock? Do you have ideas for business or inventions, but you aren't sure where to start? Are you a business owner who is looking to take your market presence to the next level? Do you lead a team, but you've lost your fire? Well, then our next feature is just the push you need. It's time to wake up your destiny. Filmed at the 2013 Provision Entrepreneurs Conference in the Now Center in Columbus, Ohio, we bring you three segments from that conference with the brilliant Simon T. Bailey. Simon T. Bailey is a leadership catalyst whose expertise equips emerging leaders with tips, tools, and techniques on how to release potential in the world's most important asset, people. He is the former leader of the world-renowned Disney Institute and founder of Brilliance Institute Incorporated. Speaker Magazine cited Simon as one of the top 25 hot speakers shaping the profession. He is an author of 7 books, such as Release Your Brilliance, published by HarperCollins, which was ranked number 17 of the top 100 books being read by corporate America. At Provision Entrepreneurs Conference, the goal was to bring that seed to life and to help it burst into full bloom as you reawaken the passions, gifts, and dreams in your heart. Please enjoy session 1 from the Provision Entrepreneurs Conference with Simon T. Bailey.
My goodness.
Bless you, bless you, bless you, bless you, bless you. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. You can be seated.
It's good to be here. Do me a favor, look at the person you're sitting next to, look him in the eye, look him in the eye, and tell him you look marvelous, simply marvelous. Somebody said, I look marvelous and I feel marvelous. Well, I bring you greetings from a little small town called Windermere, Florida. We have about 2,500 residents that live in our small town. I'm married to an incredible lady who saw me 21 years ago and just had to have me. I'm sorry. So I decided to marry her and put her out of her misery. So if you ever meet Renee, don't tell her that I'm sharing this story. This is just between us, my new best friends forever. 27 years ago, my mom and dad loaded the family station wagon and drove me and my brother from Buffalo, New York, down to Atlanta, Georgia, where they dropped me off at Morehouse College. At the end of my freshman year at Morehouse, they called and said, we don't have the money to send you back to Morehouse, nor do we have money to bring you back home to Buffalo, but we do love you. How many realize a brother didn't feel the love? So I dropped out of Morehouse, moved into a drug-infested community in the southwest part of Atlanta, Georgia, a place called Peyton Place. Only had a mattress on the floor, a bright green beanbag from the 70s, a couple of milk crates turned over with a black and white TV on top of it, with a hanger hanging out of the back of the TV with a piece of aluminum foil wrapped around the hanger. How many have a visual so far? At that time, I wasn't poor, I was po. That's 2 levels below, all right? I mean, brother was so broke, I walked past the bank and tripped the alarm. It was probably one of the lowest points of my life, and it was even in that time when I believed that everything that I had experienced up until this point was not the end. I got a job at the Days Inn downtown making a whopping $5.10 an hour on public transportation, probably one of the lowest points in my life. But even at 19, though I was lost as a goose in a blizzard, I recognized that there was an opportunity where I had to own the moment. Everybody say, own the moment. Let's go to the next slide. Go to the next slide. So in 1996, after 10 interviews, a 10-page psychological analysis, I was finally hired to work at the happiest place in the world. And if you look at me, I am all about the air condition. I am not necessarily trying to work in anybody's theme park in Florida in the months of June, July, and August, but I do love my job. And so when the parks get real busy, it's all hands on deck. And I got the call that day that I needed to get up off of my blessed assurance and come and work in the park. So I find myself in Disney MGM Studios with a blue smock on, a broom, and a dustpan, my name tag saying Simon from Buffalo, New York. And I'm like, really? Really? You're kidding me, right? I went to school to do this. And I did go back to college and finish my undergrad and master's degree. I was just on the 10-year plan. So here I am at MGM Studios sweeping the streets, and I'm like, you have got to be kidding me. And I'm just, well, you know any people like that, you know, just always complaining? You know, they are more negative than an undeveloped piece of film. And so here I am, MGM Studios, sweeping the streets, and all of a sudden some guests are coming towards me, and I flash the Disney smile. And they catch a glimpse of my name tag that says Simon from Buffalo, New York. And they said, we're from Buffalo, New York. And I said, no way. They're like, where'd you go to school? Where'd you grow up? Where your parents live? You know, people from Buffalo are like that. It's like old home day. And I told them, and I said, so what have you done? And they said, well, we've gone to Magic Kingdom. We've gone to Epcot. We've gone to Animal Kingdom. And I said, now that you're here at MGM Studios, you got to do this. You got to try that. It's going to be phenomenal. You're going to love it. And they said, really? I said, absolutely. So I said goodbye to them. And a couple of hours later, I'm sitting back at my desk drinking something cold to cool off. And ladies and gentlemen, that's when I have the V8 moment. I have the whack upside the head. I said, Disney never sent me out into the theme park just to sweep the streets. They sent me out to the theme park to connect with a family who had probably saved 3 to 5 years of their discretionary income to come to Disney for maybe once in their lifetime. A family of four in a 7-day stay would spend on average about $10,000. And it was my responsibility to create a magic moment for them. Now you're probably saying, Simon, what was the magic moment? The magic moment was when I asked them, so what else have you done? And here's what you should consider doing here at MGM Studios. What I really realized, that became the moment for me when I recognized that Disney was not in the theme park business, they were in the business of creating magic moments. That's why if you even called to their central reservation today, the person would say, hi, thank you for calling Disney. And at the end of the call, they would say, and have a magical day. What I realized is the reason Disney took so long to hire me, and it's a principle that I teach that I think all businesses should catch, is that you hire for attitude, you train for success. Training does not fix what human resources doesn't catch. Because sometimes you can hire a warm body with a bad attitude and try to train that. But if you get a person that has the right attitude, you can introduce them and help them really learn how to take everything to the next level. Well, from that day forward, I really have been on this whole journey of understanding this whole thing of owning the moment. And I believe when it comes time for you to move into another dimension, another level, another area of opportunity, you will come to a place where you are uncomfortable being comfortable. And when you reach that point, it is a signpost that your season is about to change because the Father has need of you, O brilliant one.
Hi, I'm Cabby Borders. You are watching Imagination TV. If you like what you're watching and want more, check out myimaginationtv.com. The site is filled with my free-to-watch videos and articles. Also, you can purchase and download audios, videos, and ebooks by the authors and speakers you were just watching. Our website gives you the best on-demand access to the world's most fascinating motivators, producers, educators, and authors. So check it out. See you after the break.
When I talk about owning the moment and being uncomfortable, being comfortable, it's really beginning to ask what I set, I would say, 4 questions. The quality of your questions determine the quality of your answers. The quality of your questions determine the quality of your thinking. The moment you ask a question, it immerses you on a quest to discover an answer that was waiting to emerge. Here are the 4 questions. Please, ma'am, please, sir, make the note. Question number 1, where have I been? If I am going to own the moment, I must start with where have I been? Because that question, the backstory behind that question, allows us to begin to ask ourselves what is really going on real time with my life, with my business, where are the areas of opportunity, what am I going to do to take it to another level and not just settle for the status quo. Question number 2, why am I here? Why am I here? The greatest tragedy in life is not blindness. The greatest tragedy in life is to have sight but no vision. And when I really begin to understand the why am I here, I begin to have insight into what makes me come alive every single day. A number of years ago, Disney sent me to Paris to create a leadership program for Barclays Bank out of London, 1,000 of their leaders. And while I was there in Paris, I had like this epiphany, and I began to say, oh my goodness, why am I really here? What am I supposed to be doing with my life? And I went back to my room, my hotel room that night in Paris, and I asked myself this question that came out of a book that I was reading at the time, written by an author named John Etheridge. And John, in his book, Wild at Heart, John says, don't ask what the world needs, ask what makes you come alive. Because what the world needs are people who come alive. And the reason the whole why am I here question is so important, that 30 to 40 years ago, some people went to work and they settled for a chair, a check, and a cup of coffee in Cubicle Farm, and woke up 30 years later and said, this doesn't work for me. Because when you really answer the why am I here question, that then leads to question number three, what can I do? What can I do? And when you answer the what can I do question, what you discover is you don't chase money, money chases you. And the reason money chases you is because when you find your lane, you choose to let go of all of those things that no longer serve you. And you enter into a new level of relationships that have been waiting to emerge, all because you got real clear on what can I do. When you understand the power of relationships, you realize that when you are getting ready to go to another dimension, you can tell what God thinks about you by the people that he brings into your life. God would never give you an idea unless you had the capacity to make the idea happen. But what you are no more than one idea, one relationship, one phone call away from somebody that has the door, that has a connection that you need. And I believe before this weekend is over, somebody's getting ready to get a hookup. Somebody's getting ready to get a connection. All because when you answer the question, what can I do? Everybody that has been assigned to aid and help you will begin to show up in your space almost as if they have been summoned to you. Let me prove the point. When you go to the scriptures, there's a passage in Genesis where it talks about Abraham and the lad going up. And Abraham says, the lad and I will go up and we shall come again. Yes, you remember that? Everybody know their word? Well, what's interesting, all of a sudden, Abraham is about to sacrifice his son, and his son says, Dad, where is the provision? And he said, God will provide. Well, what you have to step back and realize, the moment Abraham said, the lad and I are going up, there was a ram caught in the thicket. So the ram began to make itself up the other side of the mountain, unbeknownst to Abraham, because he released his faith into the universe, and all of a sudden, at the time when he needed it, the ram was there. Now, catch this, don't miss this. He had to loose the ram in him before the ram could show up. Some of you came all the way to find out what is it that I need to tap into as I understand provision. Well, I'm telling you, it's time to own the moment and release what's in you. Why do you need to release? Because the word release is a timing word. It's a timing word. In fact, if you went to any of the grocery stores here in this area, I believe here in Columbus you have Kroger is your grocery store of choice. When you walk on the sensors, those sensors sense the moment you step on them and they open for you. Yes? Everybody tracking with me? Why do they open? Because they sense and they release. The moment the Holy Spirit senses that you're ready, everybody that has been assigned to aid and help you will show up because you loose the ram in you. Oh, somebody is getting ready to own the moment. Just say, own the moment. When I own the moment, I come into a relationship. So when I answer the question, what can I do? The relationship is I begin to relate to the cargo in the ship. And when I relate to the cargo in the ship, we have a... When I relate to the cargo in the ship, we have a relationship. What are the relationships that you need right now? Because more than money, you need relationships. One of the things I want you to think about, if you're gonna take it to the next level, if you're gonna own the moment, I want you to do an inventory of every relationship that you have, especially those of you in business. Because sometimes you can have a 50 by 60 dream, but associate with people that have 8 by 10 thinking. And as our world is moving very quickly from a point and click world to a touch and swipe world, sometimes we want broadband results, but we're using dial-up methods. It's because sometimes we have relationships that have served their purpose, but at times we need to be okay and let them go. Do I have some people in here that need to let some things go? Do me a favor, get your hands up half mass. Get your hands up half mass. And on the count of three, whatever you came here with, I want you to say on the count of three, let it go. Because sometimes you have to release into the atmosphere that I'm getting ready to let go of everything that has been stopping me. So on the count of three, let it go. One, two, three. All right, now y'all said that real conservative, but I need you to get a gladiator spirit on you, kind of like when Russell Crowe was standing in the arena and he said, on my count, say as one. On three, I want you to say, let it go, but I want you to use some chutzpah and I want you to pull it from way down here like something is getting ready to let go. So on the count of three, one, two, three.
Let go!
That's what I'm talking about. Now don't stop there. Don't stop there. Because if we're going to own this moment, we then have to say, let it come. So whatever is supposed to come, the moment you open your mouth and say, let it come, something has got to begin to move in the atmosphere. So hands up like this, and I want you to say it with power, feeling, and conviction, like the very God it factor that's in you, it's getting ready to come. So on the count of three, say, let it come. One, two, three.
Let it come.
Oh, my God. Somebody just owned the moment right there. Because you can't let it come until you let it go. But the moment you said let it go, you can let it come. What's supposed to come? Material assistance, opportunities, doors, return phone calls, contracts, personnel, help. But it starts with, what can I do? Because in this economy, the best hand that will feed you is the one at the end of your wrist. Question number four, where am I going? Where am I going? So where have I been? What's question number one? Question number two? Question number three? Question number four? Do you know that some people plan their vacations better than they plan their lives? And when we answer the question, where am I going, we discover that the future is created in the present. When you arrive into the future, you call it today. But everything that you did yesterday meets you in the future and says, welcome, we've been waiting for you. If you think about it, God is a planner. Anybody that can plan the birth, death, and resurrection of his son is a planner. So how much more do you think that the Father would be okay if we begin to put some plans in place for where we're going? Because if you're going to own the moment in this economy, all of the rage right now in this economy is about the BRICA nations, Brazil, Russia, India, China, South Africa, Brazil, as you know, hosting the Olympics and the World Cup 2014, 2016. And when you talk to anybody in Brazil, they are all about Brazil. It's our time. Russia, I was just in Moscow a few weeks ago. They're investing billions of dollars in science and technology. India, within the last decade, have moved 300 million people above the poverty level. Over the next decade, India is building 1,500 schools per year to eradicate illiteracy. China, if you're a student of history, back in the 15th to 18th century, China was a superpower. Now we understand that everything that China is doing to position itself, in fact, the Carlyle Group, a private equity company out of DC, said that by 2016, China could be the very number one superpower. And then you have Africa. Did you know that over 500 million people on the continent of Africa are under the age of 24? Now, why is that important to you? Because when you answer the question, where am I going, you have to begin to act local but think global. How do you begin to say, my marketplace is not just what's in the zip code I am? How can I begin to leverage the internet and use everything I have and ship stuff all over the world? Many economists are saying that the internet alone by itself has generated an economy of $20 trillion. My question for you, oh brilliant one, you do know that you're sitting next to oh brilliant one, right? Just look at your neighbor and say, good afternoon, oh brilliant one. Somebody said, I'm glad you finally recognize.
Hi, I'm Cabby Borders. You are watching Imagination TV. If you like what you're watching and want more, check out myimaginationtv.com. The site is filled with my free-to-watch videos and articles. Also, you can purchase and download audios, videos, and ebooks by the authors and speakers you were just watching. Our website gives you the best on-demand access to the world's most fascinating motivators, producers, educators, and authors. So check it out. See you after the break.
But what's interesting, Chris Anderson, who is the author and creator of Wired magazine. How many of you have ever heard of TED.com? TED.com, all right, TED.com, incredible videos of some of the most brilliant thinkers on the planet. He has a new book out called The Makers, and he talks about there is an industrial revolution happening where people who are gifted at making things are beginning to realize that there is a distribution network if they would just get to it. Some of you right now have gifts, you have talent, you have potential, you have ability. And what I'd like to encourage you to think about, if you're gonna own this moment, what can these hands do? Just look at your hands, look at your hands. What can these hands do? Because your breakthrough, your miracle, your answer, it's right underneath your nose, it's right there. One of the things I realized in my journey, I left Disney about 10 years ago, and I'll share more of that story on tomorrow. I'll make sure it's a better hair day for me tomorrow when I see you. When I left the happiest place in the world, one of the things that I realized is that a dollar in Disney turns over at least 7 times. One of the things you begin to understand is that it is all about creating such an experience for people that they will feel the love and become the unofficial marketing department for Disney. Let's go to the next slide. Next slide. So one of the things I want you to get and really take away as it relates to owning the moment is that from today forward, you are a brand. You are a brand. The question is, what's a brand? A brand is not the product or service you sell. A brand is not the job you have. A brand is a connection, it is a memory, it is an emotion. And when you understand that, let me throw just a recent study that just came out. The Gallup organization says in their latest research, and the specific research can be found in the book called The Coming Jobs War, written by Jim Clifton, who's the chairman and CEO of Gallup. Gallup is saying that 70% of human decision-making, 70% is emotional, 30% rational. So people make a decision to buy based on how and if they feel the love. If they don't feel the love, they will TiVo you out of their lives. They're like, whatever. But when people feel the love, I was with Nationwide a couple of weeks ago. I'm on a long-term assignment with Nationwide here in Columbus. And I was here a couple of weeks ago, and I began to teach this whole concept of understanding that every time you connect with a customer, you are creating a moment. A moment creates momentum. Momentum creates monumental results. The root word for momentum is moment. The root word for momentum is from today forward, the business that you're in is managing and mastering moments. Why do I say that? Dr. Daniel Kahneman, professor emeritus at Princeton University, a Nobel Prize winning laureate, says that there are 20,000 moments in a day. 20,000 moments in a day. So when you really understand that, to put that in context, when I choose to own the moment, that moment compounded over time becomes an emotional deposit into the emotional bank account of whoever I am serving. And when I am serving them, they become the unofficial marketing department for my business. When I choose to serve people, one of the most important things we have to begin to think about, it's not so much what you can get from people, it's about what you can give to people. And when you choose to hug people with your words, what you discover is that your business might be the only Bible that people read. Christian people should be the best people in the workplace. Christian people should be number one in every place of business that they work. Why? Because if you have and accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior and you have the Holy Spirit will teach you what you don't know about. So in other words, every time you walk into that place of business, that business is blessed because, oh, brilliant one showed up. That business has to thrive. That business has to succeed because of what you carry in you. The Bible says in Ephesians 3:20, now unto him that is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that you can ask or think according to the power. You are carrying something. There is something in you that nobody else has. When you step into the room, you have the ability to change the atmosphere. Because guess what? When you walk into the room is in you because you own the room. And your very presence should change the atmosphere. There should be something about you that the moment people, I'm getting ready to go Hollywood on you, the moment people step into your matrix, they can pick up on the energy that there is something powerful about you. But you have to own the moment. Now, how do we get there? Let me give you some practical things. Owning the moment looks like this. Most businesses, and let's just take a bank as an example. A bank would say our operating hours are 9 to 5. When you choose to own the moment and create a wow for customers, your operating hours might be 9 a.m., but what if you open the doors at 8:45? That becomes a surprise. It becomes like a wow. It's like, oh my goodness, they actually did it. It's phenomenal, amazing. How many of you that own businesses, you don't have to raise your hands, but you know who your top customers are, the top 20% that drive the 80%. You know the name of the dog, the cat, the niece, the nephew, the son, the daughter. You understand what makes them tick. Not too long ago, there was an article in New York Times talking about how the restaurant business in New York City is very cutthroat, margins are very thin, and that they have had to dive into what they're calling customer science. Customer science says if a person comes to the restaurant, what is it that we know about them? Do they like soft butter, hard butter, Coke versus Pepsi? Where do they like to sit? How long did they stay? They put all of this information in the system to create an emotional connection, an emotional hook. If people don't feel the love from your business because they have people who just look like they have drank a bottle of molasses, people are shopping everywhere else because they don't feel the love. Now just think with me for a moment. Think of your favorite brands. Your favorite brands that have created an emotion, have created a memory, have created a connection with you. How many of you have told other people about their business? How many of you? And did they send you a check at the end of the year? Not. But why did you do it? It's because you chose to own the moment. Another practical idea, think about owning the moment. When I was at the Mouse House, one of the things they taught us is that from the time a person calls Disney to actually physically showing up and then leaving, there are 70 touch points in the experience. Each touch point becomes an emotional hook that reinforces, I done paid all this money, I made a good decision. Because the moment they stopped feeling the love, they said, why did we come here? Why did we spend all this money? Then they get the credit card statement, blah, 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 blah. So that's why they painfully hire slow, because they realize in the month of July, if a person is in Epcot and they cannot find where they parked their car when they came in at 9 o'clock in the morning, they need somebody that will come over with a smile and say, let me help you, instead of saying, that ain't my job, I can't help you. Seriously? Really? You're kidding me. And there are some people that work for businesses, and those people need to be invited to find their happiness elsewhere because they are not in their lane. And when they are not in their lane, you can call on Jesus, you can pay tithes, but if you have bad health, that doesn't get it. Baby, cause them to bounce. Step, love you, mean it, wouldn't want to be you. I know this is radical. I know this is radical. But I believe if we are Christian people, we need to be nice people. Christian folks are some of the meanest people. I'm not talking here. I'm just talking out there. Some of the places I went. Get them on the phone. Yes, thank you for calling. Seriously, really? And he died for you. Is that all you have? Where's the joy? Where's the joy of the Lord? Anytime people call you and get your place of business, there should be so much love and energy on the phone that even if they don't do business with you, they will get in their car and say, I just got to come and see what's happening over here. All because somebody decided to own the moment. Another practical tip. Coach in private, celebrate publicly. When people do things right, celebrate them. This is a tough lesson for me. I didn't get this lesson for a long time. When I first got promoted into leadership at Disney, I got my Corporate American Express card, my name on the door, my assistant. I thought I was hot stuff. The reality is I was clueless as a leader. But I didn't want you to know that I didn't know, so I pretended like I knew. How many know people like that? And how it was proven that I was a dysfunctional leader, saved, filled with the Holy Ghost, but dysfunctional. How it was proven that I was dysfunctional, people started to leave me as a leader. And when we went through the exit interview, oh, Simon, it's just time to move on, for me to move on in my career. That was the official answer they gave me face to face. The unofficial answer is that guy's a jerk. It's all about him. He doesn't care about me. He throws us under the bus. He's just trying to build his career on our backs, and then he's moving on. That's what they said about church boy. Can we have a real conversation? I wouldn't want to go any place where I can have a real frank conversation. So my boss called me in the office because I went through what they would call 360-degree feedback, where your peer leaders and direct reports rate you on your performance. If 5.0 is the highest, 1.0 is the lowest, the threshold for leaders at Disney had to be a 4.0 or higher because they believe in excellence. Where I came in at 3.5, 3.0 in many of the categories and many of the questions. Such questions as, do you trust your leader? Does your leader give you feedback on your performance? Does your leader spend time with you? Does your leader even know not just your name, but what makes you tick? And I scored very low in all of the categories and all the questions, about 100 questions. My boss, Larry, calls me in. He says, walk me through a typical day when you come in the office. I'm like, well, I come in the office, read my email, return my calls, and then I'm off to a meeting. He says, do you ever stop to take time to engage your staff or what Disney calls cast members in dialogue? I said, dude, I'm from Buffalo, New York. I don't care what they did this weekend. I don't care what the name of the dog, the cat, the niece, the nephew, the son, the daughter. You got the email. You got the memo. You're for it to create magic. That was my attitude. And he just looked at me and said, that would be your problem right there. So for the next 18 months, once a month, I had to go to Disney University to really understand what it meant to be a leader in the culture. And something that has stayed with me, even though I've been gone for 10 years, it stayed with me, is that, and this is something all of us intuitively know, people don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. When I understood that, I was invited to own the moment because I had created a memory, I had created a disconnection, and I had created a negative moment. And I recognized that I had to change my behavior. Because if I didn't change my behavior, Disney was going to invite me to find my happiness elsewhere. And if the truth be told, I needed my job. So I had a little incentive. All right? Now, let me show you what change looks like. Because some of us have got to begin to think about, there are some things that we need to change. Why change or be changed by change? Change is your friend, not your foe. Change is a brilliant opportunity to grow. When you change, you are being invited to step into another dimension. Notice I said dimension and not level, because when you study string theory, there are 8 to 10 levels in one dimension. So change. Everybody hold up your arm where your watch is. Hold up your arm where your watch is. Watch a piece of jewelry. Hold your arm up. And I want you to take your watch off. Take your watch off. And I want you to put it on the opposite wrist. Put it on the opposite wrist. Now, if you don't have a watch or jewelry, borrow something from your neighbor and tell them I'll give it to you at the next provision conference. I'm going to put it on fast. I'm going to put on Gary's bill. Now, let me ask y'all a question. I sound like I'm from Texas. Let me ask y'all a question. This is the interactive part. How does it feel having the watch on the opposite wrist? How does it feel? Weird. What else? Awkward, what else? Uncomfortable. How many of you within the last 18 to 24 months to go to another dimension have had to do some things weird, have had to do some things out of the ordinary, have had to do some things that were uncomfortable? Guess what? It's not gonna stop. Because if you're gonna own the moment, oh brilliant one, you've gotta say, what do I need to do? Not because I have to, but because I want to. Now, here's a real test. For the remainder of the conference and tomorrow, leave the watch on the opposite wrist. I know some of the blood is draining out of your faces right now. One lady shot me a look like a deer staring at headlights, all right? Say what? Here's why. Here's why. After working with 1,000 organizations over the last decade on 6 continents, what I have discovered, the reason people don't own the moment is because they have emotional equity in the way they've always done it. Why did he just ask me to move my watch on the opposite wrist? As soon as this session is over, I am putting my watch back where it was. Whatever! Huh? And here's why. I want the watch to serve as a reminder as you go to the breakout sessions, as you listen to the rest of the speakers. What am I being invited to change and own? Because if I don't own it, we will be at this movie this time next year saying, what happened? Nothing changed. All right, now, go to the next slide, next slide, next slide. One of the things that I think it's important, one of the concepts that I'm teaching and have been for the last few months is this concept called, how do I shift from average to brilliant? Everybody say this with me. Say, Simon says, I am brilliant. Now turn to your neighbor and look at them and say, I'm brilliant, but I am a little concerned about you. Okay. I am brilliant. When I talk about this whole brilliant concept and releasing your brilliance, which is really what I'm known for, when I wrote the book Release Your Brilliance, and now the new book, this Owning the Moment, the Vujia Day Moment, Shift from Average to Brilliant, I based it on some of the research work of Dr. Howard Gardner, who is professor of education at Harvard. Dr. Gardner, he and his team of researchers did an interesting study over a 20-plus year period, and what they discovered is that children up until the age of 4 are operating at the genius or brilliant level. This same group of children were studied in their early 20s, and only 10% were still operating at the genius or brilliant level. And in their late 20s, early 30s, only 2% were still operating at the genius or brilliance level. So the question becomes, where did the genius go? The genius didn't go anywhere. The brilliance didn't go anywhere, but it became buried by a society that says, color within the line, sit down, give it back, you can't do that. And the more a person continues to hear what they can't do, where they can't go, and who they can't become, there is a neurological path that's created in the brain that causes individuals to shut down. So what happens is they get a glimpse of their brilliance, a glimpse of what they could be, but here's what I've discovered. Your brilliance, your insight, your genius, your God it factor is released in an environment where you are celebrated rather than tolerated. And when you're in an environment, when you're in an environment that celebrates you rather than tolerates you, that environment invites you to be a vitamin, not just an aspirin. And when you understand how to take your potential, your genius, your God it factor, you own the moment and recognize, I do not exist at this period in history. Though I might be from London, Portland or Puerto Rico, just to exist. I am here to leave an imprint, not just make an impression. And when I make, oh my God, I feel my help coming on. I said I'm gonna give a very corporate presentation.
Hi, I'm Cabby Borders. You are watching Imagination TV. If you like what you're watching and want more, check out myimaginationtv.com. The site is filled with my free-to-watch videos and articles. Also, you can purchase and download audios, videos, and ebooks by the authors and speakers you were just watching. Our website gives you the best on-demand access to the world's most fascinating motivators, producers, educators, and authors. So check it out. See you after the break.
But from the culture I come from, something starts moving on the inside of you. Now let me dial it back and act like y'all nationwide. So, as I was saying, whatever. When you understand the potential, the genius, the it factor in God that God has put in you, you understand that I am not here to compete against you, I'm here to complete you. And when I understand that I'm here to complete you, what I realize, I don't operate with fixed pie thinking. Fixed pie thinking says there's only so much of the pie to go around. I operate in the spirit of abundance. So you can tell what God is thinking about you because, oh, brilliant one, the reason you had to come to a place called faith life so that you can discover that the brilliance was always in you. And because the brilliance is always in you, you understand, I can own the moment. I could change the world. I could create the future. And here's what, here, you catch this, don't miss this. Everything that you've ever learned from Gary is not about you. It's about the generations coming after you. Everything that I read in the Bible speaks to me about generational wealth, generational blessing. So when I find my lane, and I own the moment, I no longer am average, I am brilliant. When you are brilliant, you should be the best at what you do. There should be a high demand for people to work with you because you are operating in your brilliance. One of the things that I'm doing in my profession, I was impacted by a quote from Eric Hoffer, a noted philosopher, who says, in times of change, the learners will inherit the earth, while the learned will find themselves beautifully equipped to live in a world that no longer exists. When I read that, I said, have I stopped learning? And is there an opportunity for me to grow? So I've enrolled in a class online from Wharton School of Business on gamification. Anybody know what gamification is? Well, I'm gonna explain it, and all of us will realize we are experiencing gamification all along. Have you ever received a coupon in mail for a discount for something and you said, I'm gonna go and do this, and they asked for your information and then they emailed you again, all right? That's a form of gamification. How many of you travel and you stay at your favorite hotels, your favorite airlines, you get points and rewards? That's gamification. So it's really understanding, why do people behave a certain way and why do they buy? Well, as I've been looking at this over the last few weeks and really thinking about how do I own the moment, what I recognize that if I'm gonna be relevant in this economy, I must become, don't miss this, an original voice and not an annoying echo. When you are an original voice in your industry, you are a thought leader. You are leading where things are going, you're not catching up. In other words, oh brilliant one, you become a game changer. And God brought me all the way from Orlando, Florida to let you know that he's getting ready to release a game-changing anointing over your life. In other words, my God, did y'all catch that? There's about to be a game-changer anointing. In other words, you're not gonna do business as usual because you don't go to an average church, you don't associate with average people, you're not an average thinker, you are brilliant. Some of you in this provision conference, within the next 7 days, are getting ready to get fresh insight, fresh revelation, fresh know-how, because you're sick and tired of being sick and tired and sick and tired of the status quo. And I believe that if you name the name of Christ, you should have witty inventions. You should be the next Apple. You should be the next Oracle. You should be the next Microsoft. Hello, somebody. Now, why do I say that? Right now, ladies and gentlemen, all of the research says that there is a disappearing middle class. Disappearing middle class, like gone. So then the question becomes, if you've read Thomas Friedman's book, The World is Flat, where his hypothesis and really his thesis is, there's gonna be people at the top of the company that set strategy, then there's gonna be people at the bottom of the company that execute it, and there's no middle management. So then the question I have to ask myself, what do I do? That means you're gonna have to own the moment and create it. In other words, from today forward, you are the CEO of U Incorporated. That means for all of you that worked in a job, you are now a self-employed employee. Why do I say that? You do realize that your corporation, for those of you who work for big companies or mid-sized companies, companies do not wanna be in the healthcare business. That's why there's a whole shift on the planet right now to wellness, because the healthcare companies are gonna give them a better deal and a better break if people are well and not treating them on the back end because it drives up their costs. Y'all tracking with me? So then you have to begin to say, if I'm the CEO of Me Incorporated, how can I begin to understand how this business works? Because the person that knows how will always have a job, but the person that knows why will always be the boss. So how do I begin to think differently? Hello? And own what I do. In other words, how many of you worked inside a company or worked for someone? Raise your hands, please. All right? From today forward, you are an intrapreneur. An intrapreneur, a term first introduced back in the 70s, an article written in Economist magazine, is a man or woman who helps an organization get better by using entrepreneurial thinking. If you do your job the way you have always done it, you will be replaced. Because there's somebody halfway around the world that if technology continues to advance, they can do the job remotely. So what you have to begin to say is, how do I not wait for the company to ask me to do something? I'm gonna look at how do I disrupt what I have always done and take it to another level. Last week I was in Chicago talking with a young man. And he, in a matter of 8 years, he went from a teller to being a regional vice president. I said, how did you do it? He said, I went to my boss and I said, what is it that you don't like doing? How can I take that off your plate? And he took it off of his boss's plate, and when his boss went on vacation, who do you think he left in charge? Let me give you insight. You never get promoted until you become overqualified for a position you're in. You become overqualified when you begin to say, what is it, oh, brilliant boss, that I can help you do? What can I do to help you be successful? When you walk in the door Monday morning, they ought to know that you've been to the provision conference, because when you walk in there, you're saying, you're not gonna get there. You're supposed to be there at 9, get there at 8:30, 8:45, because brilliant people just don't show up on time. They are before time. How many of you ever participate in conference calls? Just say in conference calls. If the conference call starts at 10 a.m., the real meeting starts at 9:45. Get on the conference call early, because it's in the small chit-chat that you build a relationship. Another strategy. If the company has tuition reimbursement money, use it. Right now, companies are looking for men and women who are gonna take the bull by the horn and create innovation. Innovation, as I define it, is the intersection of insight and information. Now, here's what they're saying right now. In fact, one of the leading educational specialists out of Harvard is saying most of the kids being educated right now are being educated in a 20th century model that when they come out of school will not have the critical thinking skills to help the business advance. Right now, the leaders of America are sitting in 5th to 12th grade right now. And if we're gonna own this moment, we must begin to say that it is not so much about information, It's about what do I do with what I know and how do I apply it every single day. Renee and I are spending incredible time with Madison and Daniel, our children, and really trying to find out what is their skill set, what do they love doing, and how do we begin to help them own the moment. Because here's what we've discovered. The word education comes from a word called educare. Educare means to draw out, not put in. So now you have a system that is teaching you how to pass a test and not how to think. But just put your right hand on your head and say, I got my mind back. I got my mind back. If you're going to own this moment, you must begin to think like you have never thought before. Now, here's the other thing in owning the moment. I want you to put together a personal board of directors. Personal board of directors should be made up of 3 to 5 people that have a skill set, a competency, a talent, a gifting, or ability that you do not have. I want to invite you to get with them over the next, at least every 90 days. Get with your personal board of directors. When you get together with them, you're going to take those 4 questions that I gave you at the beginning, and you're going to answer those questions, and you're going to share them with them, and they're going to share it with you. Because the Bible says, iron sharpeneth iron. If you are going to shift from average to brilliant, you've got to hang around sharp people. Now, let's just do something. Get next to your neighbor and rub shoulders with them. Come on, rub. Rub shoulders with them. Rub shoulders with them. That's it. Here's why I had you do something so hokey and cheesy. If iron sharpeneth iron, that means what I carry is about to rub off on you, and you are about to rub off on me. And if you're going to rub off on me, how do I rub off? Because I say that figuratively, not literally. I rub off by how I think, by what I say, by how I show up, by the books I read, because leaders are readers and readers are leaders. You cannot lead if you're not feeding on something that challenges you to be brilliant. Is this helping anybody? I don't know what it is, Gary. I feel a James Brown spirit. Ow! I feel good. I don't get out much, so y'all have to excuse me. I need a little etiquette training. Okay. Let me give you a couple of things, and then we're going to do something that you've probably never done at Provision, but it's going to be fun. All right? Y'all want to have a little fun? All right. Let me give you a couple of things. A number of years ago, a man was having a reoccurring dream of a ferocious lion chasing him. And whenever he would have this dream, he would take off running. And one day he went to see a counselor, and the counselor said, the next time you have the dream, I want you to stop, face the lion, and ask the lion, who are you, and why are you chasing me? So sure enough, a couple of weeks goes by, this guy has this ferocious dream of this lion chasing him, and he takes off running. But then it dawns on him what the counselor says, so he stops, turns around, faces the lion, looks the lion in the eye, and asks the lion, who are you? Why are you chasing me? And the lion says, I'm your strength and courage. Why are you running from me? I don't know what you have been running from, but I want to invite you, because of the finished work of Christ that exists in you, if you're going to own this moment, I want you to turn and face it, because that's your breakthrough. That's your release. That's your game changer opportunity. Some of you have been impregnated with ideas. You've been thinking about things that you should do. I am, the longer I live, I am convinced that God would never give you an idea if you did not have the capacity to bring it into the earth and to bring it to pass. No matter what you have to go through, why do I say that? So here I am working at the happiest place in the world. And I reached a point when I felt that there was something bigger in me. So I put my resume out on the street. And eventually, I cashed in my entire 401k with significant Disney stock and decided to leave the happiest place in the world, turned down 4 job offers, 2 vice president's offers, a senior director position with Flexjet, a division of Learjet, the head of all customer service for Learjet owners in the world. Turned out an internal move at Disney. Why? Why did I turn that down? Because I reached a moment when I realized that I was born for more. And that this wasn't quite working for me anymore. And I am here to tell you, when God is getting ready to move you into another dimension, you will discover that frustration is a gift. Because the moment you become frustrated, you say, baby, I'm done. I'm over it. I'm out of here.
Hi, I'm Cabby Borders. You are watching Imagination TV. If you like what you're watching and want more, check out myimaginationtv.com. The site is filled with my free-to-watch videos and articles. Also, you can purchase and download audios, videos, and ebooks by the authors and speakers you were just watching. Our website gives you the best on-demand access to the world's most fascinating motivators, producers, educators, and authors. So check it out. See you after the break.
And what happens is, all of a sudden, you step into this dimension. So the dimension that we have stepped in, and it's been our mission for the last 10 years, is that our purpose is to inspire 10% of the world's population to brilliant action. You are now a part of the 10%. We've reached almost 1 million people. And listen, when I left Disney, I stepped out on nothing. Mom and Dad said, we love you, we'll pray for you, we're here if we need you. But they couldn't hook me up with nothing. And that's why when Gary talks about getting the money thing right, when your kids graduate from college, you should be so blessed that you can buy them their first house and car paid for cash. And give them a little something, something to put in the bank. Is this helping anybody? So what I realized when I stepped out on nothing but faith, all of a sudden, people start showing up in our lives. 90% of our business is referral. I don't work, I play. Because when I found my lane, and I recognize that it was not about the money. Money start finding me. It start jumping in my pockets. I'm a walking magnet. Somebody walked up to me the other day and shook my hand and put a nice crisp Benjamin in my hand. A Benjamin is $100. Somebody said, Benjamin, Benjamin, Benjamin. For my folks from the UK, I know you have the pound. But I said, seriously? It works. Here's the point. It will work if you're working. Own the moment. Now, here's what we're gonna do. In a moment, I'm gonna invite you to stand. And I'm gonna ask you to move around this facility. We're gonna do this real quick in this room. I'm gonna ask you to find 3 people. The first person, when you find each other, I want you to share with them, what are you going to do, oh brilliant one, to own the moment. Now, I'm just gonna give you a few seconds and I'm gonna say switch. Then you gotta find the next person. Now, you know what, no, let's do it this way. Instead of moving, how about you just stand and turn around and let's do it that way because I wanna honor the time. So I'm gonna have you stand and I'm gonna have you find the first person. So turn around, find the first person you don't know and you're gonna share with each other, what are you gonna do to own the moment? Now, hold on. Let me finish the instructions. I'm so excited. Okay, hold on. All right, then I'm gonna say switch. And you're going to find the second person. And you're going to share with them what you're going to do to own the moment. Then I'm going to say switch again. You're going to find the third person. And you're going to share with him or her what you're going to do to own the moment. But it'll be on my count. Now, you're going to have maybe about 20 seconds to 30 seconds. So that means you got to get it out. And then I'm going to say switch, okay? So on the count of 3, everybody up, find your first person. 1, 2, 3. Find your first person. What are you going to do? Switch, switch. switch, switch.
Next slide.
Okay, switch, switch. Okay, head back to your seats. Head back to your seats. Now, for the remainder of the day and even into tomorrow, I want you to think about, what am I going to do to own the moment? Before your head hits the pillow tonight, I want you to write this down, what you shared with Oh Brilliant One, what you're going to do to own the moment. Because when you understand the law of diminishing intent, the law of diminishing intent says, if I do not share or teach or move on what I have learned, the intent to do it diminishes. So I got to think, within the next 24 hours, I got to do this. Now, I want to share a video with you of a company that saw an opportunity to own the moment. So let's go ahead and roll that video.
Well, we've told you how tweeting can help you get better customer service, maybe even some freebies. Here is more proof. This is a tweet from a guy about to board a plane from Tampa to Newark. Hey, Mortons, can you meet me at Newark Airport with a porterhouse when I land in 2 hours, okay? Thanks. Smiley face. Peter Shankman was joking, but check it out. When he got off the plane, there was a guy in a tux with a steak and all the fixin'. Somehow, Morton's Steakhouse figured out his flight information, drove more than 23 miles, and delivered his wish, and that's what was left over after the meal.
Wow.
This guy is a social media giant. This was a brilliant PR move by Morton's Steakhouse.
You know,
it's all over the internet.
I need to tweet something. I'm getting
hungry. Exactly. I want a steak.
Now, here's the question. How much did that cost Morton's? How much? Next to nothing, right? All right? But they decided to own the moment. Ladies and gentlemen, I want you to pay attention and begin to look around and say, what is it that I need to do to own the moment? You know why this is so near and dear to my heart? So my previous book was Release Your Brilliance. HarperCollins had the first right of refusal on my next book. I went to them with the Vujade moment, this whole thing of owning the moment, and they said, well, you know, if we publish your book, we have about 18 months to get the book out. I said, really? Wow. What a concept. I went to Amazon.com CreateSpace and got it out in 8 days. Because when you decide to own the moment, you have to unlock the inner Madagascar in you and move it, get to it. Somebody says, I don't know about Madagascar. Go rent the movie. You'll see it. The whole theme song is move it, get to it. In this economy, ladies and gentlemen, you got to move it, and get to it. So listen, I'm going to stop there. Don't miss tomorrow. I'm going to unpack something on you tomorrow that I've been chewing on and wanted to release it here. It's going to be a continuation of, this was just the introduction. We were getting to know each other. Tomorrow, I promise I'm going to be very prim and proper. I'm going to act like I got good sense. I'm going to totally, you know. But don't miss it, okay? Thank you so much.